And today, so let us welcome Pastor Simon.
Wait, it's okay. The line is great. Okay. All right. I ask. Let me get the formalities straight. That's enough. Good morning, church.
Morning.
It's still morning. How long do I have? If you have heard that I can speak from morning till evening, how long do I have? Because it's about noon already.
Take your sweet time.
Praise the Lord. Oh, my soul. You are not going to regret it. Anyway, good morning, evening, church. It's a privilege to be here. I really want to thank the pastors here for inviting me. Right? And I've been having a good time of fellowship with the Foursquare people, especially the pastors. As far as I'm concerned in Foursquare, I'm a submarine. I don't like to get into position, high position. Okay? I'd rather be a submarine until this year. And just a bit of a disclaimer, I am not the pastor from Penang Christian Center. When it says the pastor, means like senior pastor. I was one of the pastors, young adult pastors. Okay, but I was the senior pastor of Borneo Christian Center. You saw the picture. Many people are afraid of COVID, and I thank COVID because one of the participants says, your picture, and now everyone looks prosperous. Okay. I said, yeah, thank God for COVID. Okay, I lost 4 buttons. And then because of this year's Christmas, I gave 1 more button. So now I lost 3 buttons. That's what I'm saying. So yeah, COVID caused me to be healthier. And again, it is true that I was a Sunday school teacher. Okay, I was a Sunday school teacher. And how many of you have seen Chinese movies? Like, they have all this. Okay, okay, we don't do this, but we definitely do all this. I did all this, and I knew how to draw talisman. Then you wipe that, the red card, the red talisman, the bird, the drink, and all that, yeah. And I had to take dry talisman for 49 days in my practice. And it's paper roll and drink with water, like juice. Ah, and I love religion. I just love religion. I was telling the earlier service that my house in Penang, growing up, there were 2 huge Indian temples behind, Hindu temples behind. Okay, during the month of January or February, where Thai Pusam happens, okay, I will be waking up very early to rush to the temple and watch how they go well. Push through. Hello, Chinese only push through 1 hole, okay? The Hindu push through 2 holes. And I, little kid, I will be there in front watching. And how many of you are from Chinese? Most of you are Chinese. How many of you are first generation Christians from the Chinese? This one. And you know that during Chinese New Year, 1 month before, we let the God go back to heaven. Sang Sina. I don't know how to say it in Cantonese. We have a farewell ceremony for them. Being the eldest grandson or the eldest son, wow! I get the privilege to clean the altar, okay, to rub the brass urn. And I love doing all this. Until I met my uncle, my grand uncle, okay, who was a master. And I follow him and I learn. And I learn. And I learn. Okay, and I'll tell you the rest as I continue to put the stories in between the message. Okay, I'll stay with it and I learn and I learn. Alright, okay, let's pray. Father, we want to thank you for this morning. Again, I want to lift the church before you and ask that it is you who anoint this message. It is prepared by men, but inspired by you, just like the Bible. Written by men, inspired by you. So even right now, begin to soften our hearts, open our ears, that the words become living seeds that will grow in our life. And I thank you right now, in Jesus' name I pray. And all God's people say,
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Now I'm going to tell a story. Okay? The devil is involved. Okay. I'm going to tell a story. Imagine this with me, huh? Imagine this with me. There is a community, a farming community. This morning, because I was in a Tamil service, I said, imagine that in India. Farming society. Okay, so they were having drought. It was drought, that means there's no rain, no water. Okay, so the pastor was saying, church, let's come together and pray for rain. Okay, let's pray for rain. So next week, Sunday, we can come earlier and we're going to pray for rain. And just like normal, every Sunday, and next week Sunday, the pastors was waiting at the front of the door of the church. I was saying that this morning, Pastor Nagu came out looking, and we were sitting in the car, we were early at corner. And I saw him walking out twice, early looking for the speaker of the day, God missing. No speaker, he has to speak. So he was outside waiting for the congregation to come in. As the congregation came nearer to the church, he stopped them. Stop! Go back. Go home. Service is cancelled. Now, if you come to church, your pastor will then you'll be scratching your head. But you're obedient, you go back. Next week they came. The same thing, the pastor says, stop where you are and go home. Service cancelled. On the third week, they came and the pastor did that. Stop, go home. They're like, what? Is pastor lazy? Didn't prepare his sermon for 3 weeks. That's why got nothing to preach. So they were like, pastor, what's going on? I said, guys, it has been more than a month. We have no water. Because that's the third week. Okay? We have no water. Our crops are dying. Yes, that's why we are here. We have to pray for rain. Listen here. The pastor said one thing. Where are your umbrellas? Where are your umbrellas? Remember, farming community is not like you have an underground basement car park. You can park your car. You can walk up from your house to the church drive. Farming communities, they walk to church. And they're going to walk back. Where are your umbrellas? Do you understand what I'm saying? If you're going to believe in praying for rain, you better be prepared. Which means, if then you don't bring umbrella, where is your faith? Where is your faith? Are you with me?
Yes.
Now, I'm asking you today, as Christians today, how many of you don't have an umbrella? What I'm saying is this, when you pray, you only hope that God will answer. Pray, every day pray, but you just hope that God will answer one of your prayers. You did not even pray with an expectant heart. The Bible says what? Believe in your heart that you have received it and you shall receive it. Mark 11:24. How many of you believe in that? Sure. You got an umbrella? You got in the car, didn't bring it to church. Then between here and car, rain and out. Rebel, God, you see, that's the thing. That's the thing about our life as Christians. You've heard that I have been in such a practice to the point that I was a 75% master, which means the last thing I need to do is to cut myself, drink blood, and swear I will be a Taoist master. Okay? What did I do? We chase ghosts. We do exorcism. We do feng shui. Okay? We install deities. How many of you from the first generation Chinese, you understand where? Oh, Hong Na. Let me say that this red mark and dip on the eye, to open the eye, to open the nose, to open the mouth, to open the head, the back, the leg, the feet, so that the deity is alive, the idol is alive. How many of you understand what I'm talking about? Hoi Kong, I don't know Hoi Kong. Turn on the light. Okay? I did not help. Now, some churches, some pastors, even my own church in Penang, they say, oh, Sam was a medium. I said, since when did I say I was a medium? I was never a medium. I control medium. If I want you to come, you come. I want to get the so-called spirit to come, you come. I want it to go, you go. You don't play a fool with me. How many of you know how big is the God of War? Welcome. The God of War. One with a red face. Michael, okay? Go means go. I am God. Who cares in the name of God? In the name of Jesus, in the name of something else. And now I become a Christian. I tell you, I have encountered Guan Gong, I have encountered Kalima, I have encountered Kalima in KL. Came. He says, get off, get up. The person came out and beat up the church deacons, elders, just like that. And he says, Pastor, watch out. I said, don't worry, bring a chair behind that. Just keep quiet, sit down, probably, enough, enough. Boom, sit down, turn on move. Turn on move. Now, why am I telling you all these stories? Remember I said I practiced, I did this, continue with the message. I'm going to talk about John chapter 2. It's a very famous story, alright? If you can, you turn to the Bible, but I'm just going to give you a quick rundown. It is the wedding at Cana. How many of you remember the story? What was it, if I dare to ask? What was it about? How come the church never turned the Ravina into wine for me? But this is a lot more. You see, the thing is this. We remember that. But I want to take you out deeper into it. Okay? First, I'm going to tell you like a semi-joke in the sense that there was a wedding in Cana. Now, how many of you have been to Israel? Have you been to Cana? You remember all everything and the church was six jars, right? And I had the privilege to preach there last year. Okay? Yeah. 3 jars here, 3 jars there. It's like the whole place are full of jars. Why jar? We don't want to miss the point. Why jar? Let's go back to the story. There was a wedding celebration. Jesus' mother was there, and Jesus and his disciples were invited. Everyone follow me, it says invited.
Invited.
Okay? And the wine supply went out. How many of you know that a Jewish wedding is something like a Chinese wedding? Okay? I asked her to put the thing further so that I can move around. Why? Can you tell me why? Chinese wedding is somehow similar to Jewish wedding. How many of you again have watched Chinese movie before? Raise your hand. You all notice that during a Chinese wedding, the groom will go outside and, yeah, I'm saying. And then the poor bride will sit quietly in the chamber with a red beard, and then the candle there, and waiting for the husband. Until the husband comes and opens the veil, right?
Yeah.
This is exactly what? Something like a Jewish wedding. A Jewish wedding is where the groom goes and picks up the bride, place the bride in the chamber, and they have 7 days of celebration. That's a Jewish wedding. So by that time happened, when the wine ran out, it is already the last few days. Most of the people marble already. So, how many of you understand the word kebo? Kebo.
Busybody.
People's wedding. Jesus' mother might say they ran out of wine. Okay? And she didn't say, oh, you ran out of wine. She goes to Jesus, they ran out of wine. And what did Jesus reply? If you can look at it, Mom, what has God to do? No. Hey, woman, what has God to do with me? My time has not yet come. How many of you are actually children before? Do you dare to tell your mom, hello, hey, woman, what has God to do with me? No, no, please, you have 5-4 ministry across your face. And Jesus is that, hey, woman. Now, the thing is this. Jesus' mother, which is Mary, also couldn't be bothered. Jesus, let me put it this way. They ran out of wine. Woman, what is yours to do with me? My time has not yet come. This mother, you all do what he tells you to do. Can you understand the situation now? They ran out of wine. What's God to do with me? You all do what he tells you to do. Okay? And what did Jesus say? Take water, pour it into the sixth jar, which is used for Jewish cleaning ceremony, washing ceremony. Alright? You all know the story. What happened? Jesus asked the master of ceremony to dip. No, ask the servant to dip, take it to the master of ceremony. The master of ceremony tasted. Oh, Romani Conti, 1985.
Wow, you already know your wine, huh?
Hello, that wine cost 21,000, okay? Per bottle.
Wow.
I'll talk to Pastor Jenny afterwards. Alright, it turned out to be the best wine. That's why he says, normally people gave the less quality, the least quality, the latest. Because most of them are already. Now, this is what happened. We know the story. It says, that was Jesus' first miracle. Everybody looks at that. I want to go back to my story. Now, everything I did those days, what does it involve? It involves some sort of spirit. Spiritual authority. Okay? Look at it this way again. Jesus' mother was invited. Jesus together with his disciples were invited. You all say invite, right? Now, they have no wine. What has he got to do with me? You all do what he tells you to do. He gets them to do it. What happened? The mother involved Jesus. Are you with me? As I did my practice, I involve the Holy Spirit. This depending, Jesus' mother involved Jesus. Okay, and the title of sermon is Invite and Involve. Okay? Where are your umbrellas? You all have invited Jesus into your life. True or not? Have you involved Jesus in your prayer? Have you involved Jesus in your life? If you don't involve Jesus in your life, the umbrella is not there. Because we are going to pray without believing anything will happen. Are you with me? Alright? So now you can see that when we involve Jesus, a lot of great things will come. Because why? What does the Bible say about you and I? We are made of what? Clay. We are jars of clay. And imagine with me this, at that area, the jars of clay, washing ceremony, those things gather dust. When it rains, the dust will fly out of it, and you see, most of your garden vases, there will be spots of sand and all that. True or not? There will be gathering moss, or the green moss, very dirty. And inside that dirty jar came out Romani Conti. Came out the best wine. Okay, I'm going to look at here and I'm going to tell Pastor Jenny, these people know what is Romani Conti. Now, what I'm saying is this, we are jars of clay. When we involve Jesus, this is what you are all talking about. What is this? Water. If you allow God or Jesus to put in the water that he gives you, and you will never thirst again, an outcome from you is going to be the best wine. Because it says in John 7:38, out of within flows river of living water. We are jars of clay. But many a time, we know the Holy Spirit, we ask the Holy Spirit to fill us. but we never involve him. We say, Jesus, you are my Lord and my Savior. Okay, in Chinese it says, 救主, Savior, Lord and Savior. But we live our life this way. Jesus, you save me. I can go to heaven. But let me be the Lord of my own life. Let me be the Lord of my own life. So we can see from this Jewish wedding, the moment the mother involved Jesus, the best thing happens. And if you want the best thing to happen in your life, this is the time we need to involve Jesus. We don't just invite him into our life. We just do not confess with our mouth, believe in our heart that he is a savior. We want to involve him. And when we involve him, in the latter part of John, what he says, I will go back to my father. I will send the advocate for you. And he will lead you and guide you. One more. It continues. You are going to do greater things than I have done. Wow. Wow. Greater things than I have done. How many of you believe that? Or you only believe it in the Bible? Come on, how many of you believe that? Put your hand up. I want to see. I want to see. Put your hand up. Pastor, I'll take a picture. Really? Seriously? How many of you believe that? Seriously? You seriously? Then every chair is going to be filled by next year, July.
Hallelujah.
Because the prophecy was July. What it says? Enlarge the tent. You must be ready to encounter the supernatural in the natural because the Holy Spirit is involved. You understand what I'm saying? The supernatural in the natural. You don't have to go to a special healing encounter or special this and special that. I had one case as a Christian. One elderly man wants to see me. And it took a year for him to get to see me because either he's busy or I'm busy. And when I get to his house, lo and behold, the son says, aren't you Yong Chong? He said, hey, yeah, I know you. You are my younger brother's schoolmate, classmate. I said, yeah, but you are the one. I said, why are you here? My father wants to see you. I said, why does your father want to see me? He said, he is the monkey god medium. He was the monkey god medium. And we have been telling him about Christ. He is so adamant and don't believe and try to argue with us. So we thought that you are from that kind of practice before. It is good that you talk to him. So I ran in and I said, hi uncle. Then of course that breaks the ice. Because the uncle said, oh, you all know each other. Then the son said, oh, my classmate's older brother. Alright? So he breaks the ice. Now what happened is this. He said, okay, what do you want to tell me? I said, uncle, I don't think I can tell you anything more than what your two sons have told you about Jesus Christ. I tell you what, why don't you ask me questions that your children or your two sons are unable to answer? Maybe I can answer on their behalf from our background. So he did ask me a few questions and he begins to like, okay, turn on one light, turn on another light. Then, halfway through, I told him, uncle, stop. He says, why? I says, your monkey is outside. Huh? You can see it. Yeah. Cannot come in, right? Cannot come in. I said, why can't the monkey come in? Don't know. No power to come in. I said, am I in trance? No. I think it's because of you, but he says, because of you, but. I said, am I in trance? No, I'm talking to you normally. And your monkey cannot come in, right? He said, yeah, cannot come in. I said, I hope you don't mind, huh? He said, what do you mean I don't mind? In the name of Jesus, get out of here! Then I look at him and I said, how can? How many of you understand how can they? Okay, I said, the monkey are pathalem. Means, flip up. Monkey are pathalem now. Flip up. I said, your monkey, See, the moment you point and say, in the name of Jesus, how? You have to understand, everything I do now involves Jesus. If I can involve the other God, the unholy one, in those days, and when I became a Christian, I had better involve the real one. That's why Pastor Peter talked about the counterfeit and the real. Okay? And I look at him, and I turn around and I say, hey, uncle, if you know gangster, if you want to join gangster, what would you do? You will join as a lower rank, or you will rub shoulder with the numero uno, the number one. And he says, of course I will go with the number one. I say, you want to be the title general, the right hand man or the number one boss. I said, I mean, if you put it this way, yes, I want to be with the number one. Then he says, no, my Jesus is number one, my monkey is number one. your monkey, yeah. Yeah, you know that your Jesus up. Then I says, that was stopping you. You want to join number one, right? That was stopping you. If you know, my mother is still alive. Now, there's many a time we have a problem in bringing people to Christ because it says our parents are still alive. So I says, uncle, can I offend you further? A bit more, allow me to offend you. He says, sure. Then I ask him, if you have all the money in the world, you have all the riches in the world, okay, and you love your mother, right? Say, yes, I love my mother. Would you get your mother the best food? Go to the best place. Of course I will. Go to the best place. Fly business class or first class. Have the best food. I agree with you. If I have that, I will bless my parents as well. Amen to that? And I'm told, if heaven is a better place, are you saying that it's okay for your mother to die first? Go to hell, then only you go to heaven? Choy, no, no. Then what am I waiting for? They said, but how to tell her? I said, put it this way, uncle. If you want to join the big boss, you join first. Then you change. Then you begin to tell her. You begin to show her. Now, mommy, I have the resources. I can take you to heaven through Christ. Slowly now. And I said, what if you say not yet? And we go to hell first. And then somebody come to your mother, your children come and talk to your grandmother, the grandmother, and the grandmother accept Christ. Then you go to hell, your mother go to heaven. Too late. He was with his mom. Then how? Your decision now. Why don't you go to heaven? At the same time, you know how to wait the way. You show your mother. Okay, lah. He accepted Christ then and there. Have you got the glory? And before long, the mother accepted Christ. And now he's serving powerfully in church. Amen. Amen? Amen? See, when we involve Jesus, we will attain success. Because when we invite Jesus, it's our choice, it's our way. But when we involve God, involve the Holy Spirit, it is His way now. We do our best, let Him do the best. When we involve Him, it is His way. Lord, here I am, use me, your way. Many a time we feel very clever. Okay? Lord, here I am. My job is a subcon. My job is a subcontractor. Here I am, send Him. Here I am, send Him. Here I am, send her. Many a time when we pray, Pastor Dabu, can help pray for my family? Pastor so-and-so, can you help? Leader, can you help me pray? When my church member asked me, Pastor Sam, can you help pray? I said, what's wrong with you that you don't know how to pray? But your prayer is better. Huh? My English is better? What's the definition of better? Say, you can pray, right? Why must you subcon your prayer? Learn how to pray. Seriously, my church member dare not ask me to pray. Okay, if you want me to pray with you, can with you, come together we pray. I want to hear you pray as well. If you are, I didn't know that the main vocation of Christians are subcontractors. They subcon their prayer to others. Then they go about and do their work. So understand this. When we are in God and with God, as for God, His ways are perfect. Amen?
Amen.
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 Amen. So if we understand this, we know that there is a provision for us. God gave us this so that you can get this. You can be overflowing. Do you have it in your thing? I didn't ask you to start beginning of the year, right? You don't have this. And it says this, without faith, it is impossible to please Him. Hebrews 11:6. Faith means involving Jesus. Mary has a lot of faith. Hello? Do what He tells you to do. That is faith at work. Do you think Mary knows that Jesus will turn water into wine? No way. But the faith in her, knowing that she bore a very special child, okay, and she is very sure. Now, that was the first miracle. Mary had not seen Him doing any miracle. The faith that was, and that's why it says in Hebrews 11, without faith, it is impossible to please God. We can invite Him all we want. If we don't involve Him, nothing will happen. And then He continues to say, for whoever would draw near to God must believe that He exists and that He rewards those who seek Him. When we seek Him, we involve Him. There is already a provision for us. I will send the advocate for you. I will give you the comforter. And He is going to lead you and guide you. So sometimes I will ask, what's wrong with us? We read the Bible. We know the Bible. Sometimes we know the word inside out. Yeah, I remember this verse. Yes, I read it before. But have you involved that word? Have you involved that word? For in the beginning there was a word, and the word was with God, and the word was God. Have we involved that word? And if we know that we have involved that word, and we ask anything in His name, it will be done. It will be done, because in John 14 says, whatever you ask in my name, and I will do. John 14, verse 13 to 14, it says that the Father may be glorified in the Son. When we involve Him, the Father gets the glory. Amen?
Amen?
Amen? That is as simple as inviting Him and involving Him. The two eyes. The two eyes that work, everything will fall in place. Okay? With provision, we have the potential. We can do things that He asks us to do. Because why? How many of you believe the word in the Bible? Do you believe every word in the Bible? Every word? For me, is as long as it's in the Bible, it's fine with me. And the Bible says this in Ephesians 2. For we are His masterpiece. Oh no. Turn to the left and right. You are God's masterpiece. You are the Rembrandt of God. You are the Da Vinci of God. You are worth billions, billions. You are God's masterpiece, created in Christ Jesus. For what? For good works. So let's start working. Let's start bringing our umbrella with us. If we are going to pray for something and believe that it will happen, let's get ready. Don't just give God our lip service. Many a times, I was saying yesterday, I think, we know the word of God. Wow, yes, I get convinced, I get convicted. Great, praise the Lord, hallelujah. Then what happened? We bring it up to our head again. And then Proverbs says, knowledge puffs up. Knowledge puffs up. I want to propose this. We listen, we hear, we understand. Great, we bring it to our heart. We get convicted, bring it down to our lips. We walk up the word. Walk the talk and talk the walk.
Amen.
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 If not, Jesus is not involved. You are on your own. He is just your parking attendance. Dear Jesus, please provide me a parking place. Please, I'm coming to church. How many of you done that? Jesus, I want to park near the store entrance. Please provide me with a parking space. Your love, Jesus is only a parking attendant. True or not? Why don't you say, Jesus, your will be done? If I need to park far, it means I need the exercise. You must have a purpose, right?
Yes.
So now, if you are created in God's beautifully and wonderfully created as His masterpiece to do good works, what are your potential? If you look into the leadership gift, apostles, prophet, teacher, pastor, evangelist, pastor, teacher, wow, too high a calling, man. Okay? How about the motivational gift? How about a teacher, a person who can teach, a person who has the gift of generosity, give. A person who has the gift of hospitality, give. You understand what I'm saying? These are all your potential. But if you have the spiritual gift, pray. Word of wisdom, word of knowledge, prophecy, book of miracles, healing, faith, discerning of spirit, interpretation of tongue. Do it. I say A. The last one I don't say it because why? The last gift is speaking in tongues for you and yourself only. The rest are other people. People benefit from your gift, from your talent, from your potential. The only gift that you can only use for you, yourself, to edify yourself, is speaking in tongues. So God has provided us with the Holy Spirit, give us the potential in the Spirit, so that we have a purpose in life. What is your purpose? Earn money. The general term is this. Work. Eat. Sleep. Work. Eat. Sleep. Work. Eat. Sleep. Die. That's not our purpose in life. We are all born, sorry to say this, we are all born to die. Okay? What we do in between, let's glorify God.
Amen.
Amen. You and I have a purpose. And we should pretend. So Pastor Peter is talking about July. His own birthday is November, he keeps saying July. Why must you prophesy for yourself? Can I prophesy that by July, the extension of the tent,
Amen.
The chance will be more?
Amen.
Amen. You say amen, are you going to involve Jesus?
Oh, yes.
Then start evangelizing. Start sharing. That's our purpose. Because it says here that in Exodus, where it is, I have raised you up for this very purpose. That's God talking to Moses. And he says this, that I might show you my power and that my name might be proclaimed in all the earth. I have prayed for an old lady. I've told her testimony. And I said, do you have any disease? I said, no, I'm healthy. I said, okay. Let's just say this. Can you please go for a heart checkup? Heart checkup. Oh, my heart got no problem. Says, okay, auntie. Just go for a heart checkup. Okay? The daughter-in-law took the word, okay, sign up, get the doctor to write a letter to go to IGNKL for a heart checkup. When the specialist saw the mother-in-law, the specialist got a shock. How did you know how to come here at this stage? It's happening, some heart disease. But it says you won't know until a few more years. But how did you know to bring your mother-in-law? And because of what you know, things are done like that. This is the beginning stage. The doctor-in-law says, a pastor told us. That's all. A pastor told us. That's all. And I told people in the past, in 2018, my wife had a stroke. I have no time to tell the story. My wife had a stroke. Okay? Had a stroke. Now, for those of you who know, oxygen do not go to the brain in 4 minutes or 6 minutes. The nurse has to die. So the day that she entered the hospital, there was this gray patch from the MRI. The day she was discharged, the next day she had to go for the MRI. And then we go back to see the doctor. The doctor just couldn't explain. He says, wait, hold on, Mr. Yogram. He was looking, it's amazing. I said, what's amazing? He said, no, wait, hold on. I've got to check the best slides for you, the best MRI for you. Okay, this one. He said, you see, when the wife came in, there's this gray area of the nerve tape. And it's amazing. The MRI that happened the next day, after the discharge, 2 weeks in the hospital, nothing happened there. Everything is back to normal. It's amazing. Okay? Because when I pray, I say, God, I know some of you may disagree with me, but I'm very straightforward with God. I say, God, I do your work, healing, deliverance, and all that. Please, don't shame the ministry. You use me, heal her. If not, don't let her suffer. If you need to take her home, take her home. Fair enough? I mean, I don't let her suffer. She cannot even remember the son's name, okay? So when the doctor says it's amazing and show it to me, I say, wow, that's a miracle. The doctor has the audacity to say, sorry, Mr. Yo, I am a doctor, there's no miracle. Yeah, I told the doctor, sorry, doctor, I'm a pastor, there's a miracle. Yeah. Amen. Yeah. He may say he's a doctor, there's no miracle. I said, sorry, I am a pastor. It's a miracle.
Hallelujah.
Because why? When I pray, when we pray, when we do anything, and I do anything and everything from now on, I involve the Holy Spirit. Basically, I involve God. Okay? So we have a purpose. That's why my purpose today is to help churches, to help Christians grow. And I have a purpose statement in my life. I purpose or I exist to equip, empower, enable His people with His power for His purpose.
Amen.
Equip His people. Empowered with His power, enabled for His purpose. So therefore, I tell you, each and every one of us has a purpose in our life. What wakes you up in the morning? Not the alarm clock. Okay? Not the alarm clock. What wakes you up in the morning? What gives you that? I'm going. I am going. Because you begin to involve Jesus, this is how you're going to feel. I'm not here boasting. It has been my life, and these are the people that I have trained. And this ministry that I have trained them, I will tell them, there is no superhero ministry. One pastor don't pray for all. How many of you have received word from the leader, those in the past? Very prophetic, right? David don't come up here, he was behind. And they have words for people. So when we have the altar call, they are going to come out, Belinda, the husband, and Damien are going to come out, and they're going to pray for you as well. Don't look to the pastor. Don't look just to the pastor. I am just like you, born a sinner. I don't have 3 eyes. I have 2 eyes. I have 2 ears. I have 1 mouth. I have 2 legs. I have 2 hands. I am just like you. Worse is, I'm a very dirty jar. I was a very dirty jar. Okay, I did the occult. I have had 6 to 7 loan sharks behind my back before. Just by the age of 24, 25, I was already half a millionaire 30 years ago. I was doing very well. Money to me. All the pride that he got has to do. So if God chooses to use me today, if I feel that I'm still a dirty jar, today we don't have this. Are you with me?
No.
So when I allow God to use me fully. My testimony is all these 3 people know. There's nothing to be. No garlic, no adding of peppers, salt, and spice, nothing. They know. They know. Okay? So remember this, we have provision from God, we have the potential from God, we have a purpose in our life. just by involving him. So I want to challenge now. I don't want to propose, I want to challenge you now. Romans 1:16 says, "For I am not ashamed of the gospel." I'm not ashamed of the gospel. Amen?
Amen?
Amen? So all eyes closed. All eyes closed. All eyes closed. You don't look to the left, don't look to the right. All eyes closed. I want this time to be between you and God. Between you and God. All eyes closed. Don't look to the left, don't look to the right, don't look to the front, don't look to the back. All eyes closed. Our ministry team, just be prepared to stand. Okay? Ask yourself this. When was the last time you involved God? When was the last time you pray with an expectant heart? When? If you have been doing that, pray, praise the Lord. You will have fruits to show. But today, if I'm going to ask you, if you believe in the Bible, it says, "Go therefore and make disciples." Who are replicating your image? Who are replicating the legacy that you have? Never mind. Let it end today. If you feel that this is time to change, from now on, every step I take, every breath I breathe in, every decision I make, is going to involve Jesus. So if you are there, I want you to start putting your hand over your heart. Put your hand over your heart. If you are that person, you put your hand over your heart. I say, "Jesus, I want to make myself available to you. Fill me. Fill me with your living water. I am just a jar. I may be broken. I may be dirty. I may be just half a jar, but it still can hold water. Let it be your living water. Refill my heart right now. Refill my life right now. So that I can be overflowing for you. Change my heart. Let me see. And let me feel the pain that you are feeling. What pains you? Let me experience that. Let me experience that." Ask God right now. It's between you and Him right now. It's between you and Him. Ask God right now. Now, if you are doing that, listen to the next thing. I want you to take a step of faith. Just stand up for God and don't stand up if your neighbor is standing up. People in front of you stand up, people at the back of you stand up, or people next to you stand up. Don't stand up because they stand up. You stand up because you want to make a stand for God. It says, "Jesus, right now I'm going to start involving you in my life." Stand up right now. If you are that person, just stand up for God. Just stand up for God right now. Just right now. With your hand over your heart, just stand up. Just stand up for God. Again, don't stand because people are standing. There's no guilt, no shame, no condemnation. It just shows that you are already doing what I already talked about. But for those who are standing up, again, there's no guilt, no shame, no condemnation. It is a time of renewal. It is a time of refreshing. And as you stand up, you want to ask this God, "What are my potential? What are my gifts?" I want you to ask this question: what am I passionate about? Because God gives you that passion. What am I passionate about? What wakes me up in the morning? And ask God to extend it and enlarge that gifting, that talent. Whether it is generosity or teaching or even the spiritual gifts of discerning of spirit, praying for people, praying for healing, whatever. What are you passionate about? Even if it's children ministry, enlarge your tent. Make it to be a better teacher. If it's a youth ministry, ask God to make you a good coach to help them. If it is an adult ministry, how can I leave my legacy behind for the next generation? What are your potential? What are you passionate about? Ask God to enrich that passion right now. Let's take the third step of faith. If you have found your potential and you want it to be purposeful in your life, I want you to step out from your comfort zone and out at the altar here so that the ministry team will pray for you. Ministry team, so at the count of three, if you are ready,